Welcome to Random Assignment, starring Corey DeAngelis and understudy Bob Bowdon. But there's two other people on the screen right now for those listening to the podcast. Corey, who are we looking at there?
I don't know. I didn't make the picture. What are you talking about? This is the two main union bosses of the two largest national teachers unions in the United States. The person on the right is Becky Pringle, the president of the National Education Association, and the person on the left, Randy Weingarten, is the president of the American Federation for Teachers, which is the second biggest teachers union in the United States. Oh, and it's, I always like to note that the NEA is also the largest labor union, period, in the United States, not just the largest teachers union.
Yeah, I think I told you that on this podcast, actually. Anyway, but and the other thing is they're in lab coats. They're in, like, medical lab coats because, in a way, they're kind of scientists, right?
No,
they're
They know the science. Well, they talk to the CDC and tell them what to do, right? And didn't they get to meet with the CDC, and then the CDC director kind of changed their tune, and then they included community transmission as a marker for whether to reopen schools, which didn't make any sense if you look at the reports from the CDC researchers published in JAMA saying that there's no consistent evidence or compelling evidence that schools are contributors to the community transmission. Just weird how that changed after the meeting.
You know what else is odd? It's odd that they would actually, the scientists would need to meet not with the people in charge of running the schools, like the school districts or maybe the state commissioners of education. The state sometimes is called the superintendents of education. Not the people running the schools. That's not who they... They didn't just meet with scientists only. If they're going to throw in some sort of management people, you would think they'd be meeting with the managers of the schools. No, that's odd. Instead, they seem to have met with people giving a lot of money to candidates. Rather than the people that are actually in charge, allegedly.
It's weird how special interests work, don't they, Bob? Hey, you created an image, or someone created an image on your team with lab coats, so they must know the science on reopening schools. We talked about last week how Randy Weingarten, the president of the AFT in that photo, tweeted about, should any schools be open? Look at this data from New York Times showing that only 4% of schools should be open. Should any of the schools be open? Well, wait, right. Aren't like over a majority of the schools open for some type of in-person instruction already? Do you want those to close even though they've been doing so successfully? It's just, but at the same time, she tries to turn around and say, well, we've been fighting to push to reopen schools since last April. We've been fighting hard to do that. And I think we shared that clip last week.
It's a dizzying, fast-moving cognitive dissonance we're served on a regular basis by Ms. Weingarten and her AFT leadership. In a sec, we're going to get, this is a tease, as they say in television, we're going to get later to this suggestion that maybe school reopenings are not based on science, even though that photo seemed to indicate that these ladies, Pringle and Weingarten, are in fact scientists. There was the big story, this huge, big blockbuster story from today as we record
what
this
happened?
On March 10th, is the massive federal school COVID bill that passed. Congress has approved this. This is $128 billion. This is the giant school. Now, this is the third federal subsidy, but this is the big one. We've been talking about this before. This is $128 billion. It's mostly filtered through Title I funds. So 110 of the 128 billion, there's some other money in there for modernizing internet services and stuff like that. But the big, massive percentage majority of this 128 will be filtered through the Title I system of federal financing of schools. That's basically weighted for how many poor kids go to each school. That's how the Title I money is weighted. So what this means is it's an enormous federal check, stunning in its just sheer size, if nothing else. But if you are a better than average, if you're a district with very few poor kids, you'll receive very little of this money. Mm-hmm. And if you're a district with lots of poor kids, you'll receive lots of this money. What you don't see is any connection to the COVID rate associated with how much money you get. If you're just a poor district that's not had one COVID case ever, maybe you're an Alaska rural district, you've never had a single COVID case, you're going to get a lot of money in a per capita basis because you have poor kids. And if you are a middle class district with no poor kids and all kinds of COVID, too bad. This doesn't go to you.
And if you add all of this up, this is $190 billion for K-12 education, the vast majority of the dollars going to public schools exclusively. If you look at this rescue plan, this $123 or $128 billion, whichever the number is, and the $54 billion that was already allocated from the latest December 2020 stimulus, add that to the CARES Act as well, 13, which did have some, which is the smallest stimulus package, did have some for private schools as well. You got like $190 billion mostly going to K-12 public schools, and that's over the amount that the U.S. dedicated to rebuild Europe after World War II, also known as the Marshall Plan to rebuild Europe after World War II. This is a ton of money. If you inflation adjust the money that was spent towards the Marshall Plan, I think it was only like $130 billion or $135 billion. So this is much more in constant terms than how much we spent to rebuild Europe after World War II. I mean, this is a ton of money. And if you divide this by the number of kids, like just the two most recent, the $54 billion and the $123 billion or $128 billion, that's like $3,500 per student. You could have given all the families a choice to take that money to somewhere else that's open for in-person instruction or to leave it in the public school system. That's a pretty good chunk.
Some of this new money does go to private schools. I think you just implied that, right? I don't remember the number, but it's a small number on a percentage basis. Some of this new money is for private schools, but the overwhelming majority is for public. People have heard us talking about this, Corey, for, you know, this $128 billion had been in Congress for a while. And one of the things we kept talking about is the nonpartisan Congressional Budget Office saying that based on their analysis, only 5% would be spent this calendar year, and then another 25% next calendar year, and then over 70% from 2023 and beyond. That's what we had been told about the Congressional Budget Office. This huge spending thing, spending package, would be spent from now to 2028. And we were like, wow, that's amazing. But here is the other big news for me, Corey. I don't know if you saw this. If you could go back to that story and scroll to the very last sentence in that story, that's the one that made me jump up and sit down. Keep going lower. Are you on the? Yeah, I think that. Yeah, I think it's more. No, okay, go back up. Maybe it's not the low. Okay, maybe it's just
maybe
a little higher.
Maybe then there was an ad. There was an ad, and
oh, I see. Well, it's the part of the story that I have highlighted saying I can get the. Let's see.
Only 5% of the funding will be spent this year.
The line I'm looking for is the money must be spent by October 2023. Do you have that sentence? The money must that's the sentence.
There it is.
Look at that sentence. Now, what this says is,
wait, hold on.
Holy smokes. What we had been told is it's an enormous amount of money, but it'll be spent till 2028. Now we suddenly find out some amendment has changed, some sort of change anyway. This gigantic truckload full of money has to be spent between now and, you know, a year and a half from now or so.
I guess I'm guessing the Senate amended it to say, look, this 2028 thing seems kind of ridiculous. Let's make it spent by 2023 so that we can actually get the resources to.
I know. And I guess I'm just about 2.5 years from now, but still, nevertheless, so there are people, even advocates of this sort of largesse of gigantic ton of money being poured into the low-income school districts, whether they have COVID or not. Supporters of this who are still saying, wow, how are they going to spend that much money and then suddenly not have it? You can't hire that many teachers and then suddenly fire this many teachers. And then what about all these places like California just passed their own multi-billion dollar COVID plan statewide? There's supposed to be enough that they all they need to open up. California just had it, that had passed this. This is their big celebration.
They're gonna be buying slip and slides on campus. And what do we do with the money? We gotta exactly. Spend it, and it's not gonna be used for safety.
So this is my message: if you out there, gentle listener or viewer, are a vendor and you sell some kind of stuff to big school districts, this is your moment, my friend. Get on the phone tomorrow morning with every contact at every low-income kid school district you know, because they have got cash coming out of their ears and they are going to be looking for some way to blow it somehow. So this is your time. You got something to sell a district. I don't know what it is. Something fancy they don't need. I don't know. Like, how about Rolls-Royce school buses? This is your time to sell that to a school district.
I mean, the money that was already allocated, Bob, the $13 billion for the CARES Act and the $54 billion through the second stimulus bill, the majority of the funding, the vast majority of the funding has not been spent yet.
Also true.
What?
Also true. But now they're going to spend all this in two and a half years.
And this is the biggest stimulus of the three by far. $128 billion.
And all kinds of districts with no COVID are going to be spending this. Districts with no thousands of districts.
Districts that are already open. Districts that are already open for in-person instruction. They're going to get money too.
All the above. Yeah, exactly. So about a third of the districts are already open. Another third roughly are what's called partially open. So kind of hybrid. So there's all kinds of districts that are open with no COVID, and so they got to spend it, you know. So,
and in the Senate, when they had it, the Republicans were trying to pass an amendment that would make the funding contingent upon reopening the schools for in-person instruction.
Well, that's true. That's a whole other thing.
All the teachers were vaccinated, they couldn't pass that. It was a 50-50 block. It was the Blunt Amendment number 48 not too long ago. And that just, you know, if it's for reopening the schools and you have all the teachers vaccinated, why was that a problem to pass to make the money contingent upon opening? Maybe because it's not about opening.
Yeah, well, that's both the California bill that I've talked too much about and this national one. You make a great point, Corey, as you often do. The schools can just have all this money whether they open or not. The teachers unions, in other words, can continue to use it as a collective bargaining tactic to say, we still haven't said we're going back to work, and so why don't you, as they said in Los Angeles, why don't you create a full day daycare, which had never been the case in LAUSD, but because of COVID, now they've got this through. Why don't you, in the Sacramento district, we heard this new bargain, the union has now said, we'll go back to work. One of our conditions are childcare for teachers, meaning our own kids will have free childcare for the teachers because COVID, whatever, we're going to have this new job benefit, which is childcare for our own kids. And so that never existed before. What does that have to do with COVID? How does that slow the spread of COVID in Sacramento public schools? It doesn't. It's just a way to get stuff out of the crisis.
There was another bill in Congress, which it was federal benefits for government employees to be able to pay for childcare services because of school closures. So the public employees get to take money of us through the tax system, and they're fine with their schools being closed because they can pay for the out-of-pocket expenses through the taxpayer funding. But then the rest of us, we're feeling all the brunt of it when it comes to our schools being closed. It's everybody should have that choice. Everybody should be able to have their dollars and take them elsewhere.
I mean, all right. So let me ask you a question about. So I'm sorry, I interrupted.
Okay, go ahead.
Go.
I was just going to say there's a lot of other teachers unions that recently voted not to return to work in person. Los Angeles Teachers Union, 91% of them recently voted not to return to work in person. You had Seattle and Cleveland do the same thing. They just decided, okay, well, we did a vote.
Although Los Angeles did announce a big deal with the district and the union leadership. We'll see if the rank and file supports it. They probably will. But anyway, let me ask you just a different question. So readers of the Wall Street Journal, what did they come across today? Can you point to anything that if someone decided to pay for the paywall of Wall Street Journal, that I was such a reader would have found?
Nah, there's nothing interesting in the print version of the Wall Street Journal today, but you could check this one out by this dude, Corey DeAngelis and Christos Makridis. Here it is. School isn't closed for lack of money. Subheading, teachers union influence, not government funding or the latest science drives reopening decisions. So we go over the fact that they just passed this tons of money. And then we also go over a study that we released at the same time as the release of the op-ed, which is also a social science research network, looking at nationwide data from over 12,000 school districts covering well over 90% of the school-aged population in the U.S., the study asks, are school reopening decisions related to funding? Long story short, you just read the headline of the Wall Street Journal. We don't find any evidence whatsoever, no matter how we slice the data, no matter how many controls we add to the models, no matter whether we look at expenditures per pupil or revenues per pupil, no matter if we take the log of the outcome or the level of the outcome in dollars, no matter how you look at it, school funding is not associated with the likelihood of public schools to reopen in person, which suggests that this isn't really about money and we shouldn't expect additional dollars to increase the likelihood of the schools reopening when we're talking about the federal bailout. But then we also did find strong relationships in our previous study that teachers union influence based on four different measures all predicted very strongly the likelihood of keeping the schools closed. And then we also found that political partisanship in the area, places that had more Trump voters in the 2016 election were more likely to reopen, whereas more left-leaning areas were a lot less likely to reopen. But all that aside, even after controlling for all these things, such as union influence and the COVID risk in the area and the political partisanship and income and all these other characteristics, the funding was not related to the likelihood of reopening. And we had a ton of power to detect effects. We had over 12,000 school districts. So it's not like we didn't have the statistical power to detect the effects. And so, we don't find evidence that the problem is money. Instead, it seems to be a problem of incentives and power dynamics, particularly when you look at that Brown University study finding that places with more low-cost private schools in the form of Catholic schools, their public schools are more likely to reopen, which goes to show that this probably has a lot to do with incentives and competition.
So just to be clear, you're saying if you hold constant something like, we're going to look at a bunch of different districts that have the same amount of COVID in them, and they have the same amount of political leanings in them.
Yeah.
And when we just say, well, does this, if a district with the same politics and the same COVID, if it has more money, therefore it can afford more PPE, is it more likely to open than the exact same district where everything else is the same, except it has less money per student? And you're saying is, no, actually, when you hold all those other things constant, the amount of money the district has, meaning how much it can afford this protection from virus transfer and ventilation systems and masks and all this stuff, 6-foot distancing, like the amount of money the district has zero influence when the other items are held constant.
Yep. And we ran it in tons of different ways where we include different controls. You can see yeses and nos down here with, did we include these ones, those ones, or the other ones? Did we control for this, that, or the other? And we run it a bunch of different ways. This top variable is spending. Most of the results across a bunch of the tables are insignificant, suggesting no relationship between spending, or at least revenues per membership or per student, and reopening. If anything, we find some evidence that, if anything, places that went remote actually had more money. And this is consistent with the Georgetown University analysis that we shared last week, I believe, showing that places like Los Angeles Unified School District that went fully remote had a surplus of about $500 million this past school year. And other
saved a lot of money. By not being open.
So it doesn't seem to.
Go ahead.
We also looked at just like in dollars rather than log of revenues. Log is the better way to do it, but we just wanted to run it every way. And we did log of expenditures rather than revenues as well, because it could differ, but pretty much the same. And some of the results were that, again, the remote districts, if anything, had more money. So
is it correct to say that the COVID rate had some impact on the on the opening of schools, but not as much as the teacher union power?
No.
Is that correct?
Nope.
No.
Nope. If you look at our COVID cases here and deaths here, most of the results have no stars, meaning that they're not statistically significant. The one that does have significance here suggests that the places that had more cases were actually less likely to be remote, because it's negative and positive and significant here, which is the opposite of what you would expect if it was driven by safety. But our full models don't suggest that COVID deaths or cases at the county level are related to reopening. So this is why.
So
this is
in the one example, there was a statistical correlation. It was an inverse correlation.
Exactly. It was the other direction, but we hadn't controlled for county level fixed effects in that model. And that could explain it. Places that are in the same county may have similar COVID cases or deaths. But look,
how did you measure teacher union political power? What was your, that seems like a subjective thing to some degree, but you could also, I guess, look at just things like how much money state unions get or something from dues. But I don't know, how did you measure teacher union power?
Yeah, and when we controlled for that in this study, we used county level union membership. So that's as fine grained as we could get for a proxy for union power. And I think it's a pretty good one. But in our previous study where we really zoomed in and focused on teachers union strength, we used four different proxies. We used that county level union membership. We also used whether you were in a previously right to work state or not. We looked at the Fordham Institute ranking of teachers union strength in the area. And then we also used one other measure, it'll come to me later, but we use multiple measures of proxies and they all found the same result in our previous study. But look, you can see that like political partisanship was strongly related to reopening, but not so much spending or the safety in the area. That's where the headline comes from, that school reopenings have more to do with the political partisanship and power, as talking about union power, than it does about safety. And then you just look at all the other weird stuff that we've been reporting on over the past few months or over the past year, that there's just been hypocrisy on the part of teachers union members or at least the leadership, and the stark contrast between the private versus public sectors in reopening and opening the daycares in the public schools, but not for learning. I mean, there's evidence suggesting this is not about safety, but it's more about power and politics. But then there's all these other things that we talk about in the news that also suggest this isn't really about the money or the safety. It's more about power.
Random assignment fans will remember last week's show when we showed a Berkeley, California teachers union president that had been caught on camera bringing his own daughter to in-person daycare while at the same time he was claiming in-person education was far too dangerous for the district to do. It's just, just be terrible. Exactly. Can't be in person. Kids can't be in person when it's the district.
But mine can. Mine
my
can.
Kid.
Yeah.
Right.
It was kind of like the Alexandria City public school superintendent pulling his kids out of the public schools and sending them to private once the school's closed.
People talk about the differences between Northern and Southern California all the time, but we found some similarities between Northern and Southern California in a news story from Los Angeles that came across the transom this week. Do you have the video, Corey?
Let's check it out. What happened?
A leaked social media post from a private Facebook group meant for UTLA members only is making the rounds amongst LAUSD parents tonight. In the post obtained by Fox 11, UTLA teachers are warned to stay off of social media if they take any spring break vacations. The poster writes that the optics of parents and the public seeing photos of union members traveling would be a bad look for them as UTLA continues to refuse to return to in-person schooling, citing COVID-19 safety concerns.
The frustration and almost anger that I had is just indescribable.
Renee Bailey is one of the LAUSD parents who saw the post after it leaked. She has two kids in the district, including one with special needs. Both of them have been out of in-person schooling for nearly a year now.
It was extremely frustrating as a parent to see, hey, vacations are planned as usual for teachers. Just don't put it out in public because we need to negotiate. It's horrible. When I see that post, it tells me that community spread and the safety of the teachers isn't the real concern.
In a statement to Fox 11, UTLA tells us, quote, "We have a diverse membership and they are able to post their views on personal Facebook pages and in this Facebook group. However, UTLA does not monitor nor is responsible for the content." On Friday, UTLA announced that 91% of their members voted to refuse to return to in-person schooling until all staff members are vaccinated and COVID-19 transmission rates drop here in LA County. But a deal to reopen could be coming soon.
We're making progress in our plans to reopen schools. LAUSD Superintendent Austin Buettner announced on Monday that the district expects to have an agreement with UTLA as soon as this week.
The target remains mid-April for preschool and elementary school students, as well as students with learning differences and disabilities, and the end of April for secondary schools.
The end of April, by the way. The end of April for secondary schools. So that's over a month and a half from now.
They're still just changing the goalposts, Bob. They just keep changing the date. And then when we come to the end of April, it's almost the end of the school year anyway, so we might as well.
I know.
That's exactly what it'll
be
next.
As we said, there was a deal since that story was produced. There was a deal between the teachers' union and LAUSD. But the point of this is that there was a private post. And what did it say to the teachers? This is supposed to be a private UTLA union Facebook page, private Facebook page. And it didn't say, hey, don't go on vacation because we're worried you might catch the COVID. What it said was, if you go on a vacation, please don't tell anybody about it by uploading photos because we're trying to message that it's not safe. I'm at a loss for words, Corey.
Dude.
We're trying to message that it's not safe. We're not going to tell you not to go on vacation because it's safe to go on vacation.
It's safe. It's safe to do things that I like. It's not safe to do things that I don't like or that I would prefer not to do.
We're trying to negotiate right now that it's not safe. So ixnay on the Odofay. Don't upload any photos. Don't let anybody know.
Don't have this happen.
Oh, my God. Yeah, exactly.
We can't have Chicago happen. That's exactly what it is. Oh, look, they got big pushback after she had to delete her Twitter account after vacationing in Puerto Rico while tweeting about, well, we can't go back to work. Oops.
And here's just the little postscript of the whole thing. And I don't want anybody to know this, so I'm going to whisper this again in the microphone, so I'll get it really close. But the Berkeley teacher union president that was caught on camera bringing his kid to in-person education after that broke, that scandal of hypocrisy broke, they suddenly struck a deal in Berkeley. And just after this scandal broke in Los Angeles, the union suddenly struck a deal with their district. Oh. So we just need... The problem is not too much COVID. It's too few cameramen catching people on the street being hypocrites.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, that's why you got to post in your...
All you need, you just need to embarrass the union with one of these stories of hypocrisy. Then the next thing you know, bada bing, bada boom, or whatever they say. Then you got a deal. 10 seconds later, you got a deal once they're embarrassed publicly.
If we're talking about hypocrisy, you want to see this? I don't think you've seen this one yet. So there's this Dr. Eric Feigl-Ding. He's been one of the most vocal opponents of reopening schools because he says it's not safe. This reporter, Jordan Schatchel, I don't know how to say his last name, but here it is. Here's the tweet. If I can share my video, that'd be great. Then I'll let you know. But he uncovered some hypocrisy on the part of this doctor. Eric Feigl-Ding, the chief COVID-19 panic salesman on social media, quietly moved his family to Austria in the fall so that his kid could attend school in person. Yet Feigl-Ding has been a relentless proponent for school closures here in the U.S. And so he went a whole thread about it. And, you know, hey, look, he's still saying that, England can't open their schools. Great. And so, choice
somehow
for
it's
me.
Different. They'll have a reason. They always have some reason. Yeah, they'll always be, but you don't understand. This special school in Austria has every kid's in a hazmat suit, and that's why it's like they'll have some BS, you know. Please, they always do. But
this journalist somewhere in this thread pointed out that his excuse was something like, you know, well, in Austria, yeah, it must be safer there than in the United States. Or had some arguments.
But, you know, I got to tell you, I want to your response on this, Corey. I have a friend who's kind of a traditional defender of public schools, I guess you'd say. She actually says she doesn't mind charter schools, but that's kind of as far as she goes in like urban areas. She's one of those kind of Democrats. Anyway, but she, when I present her these kinds of stories, she goes, there's always a few people who are going to be hypocrites and outliers. That doesn't mean we should pay so much attention to them. They're just a couple of anecdotes. What would you say to her?
Well, sure, but that's part of it. But you don't get to see all the story. There's a lot more than what you uncover because these things are so embarrassing. And, you know, if you look at the evidence, seeing that the private schools are more likely to reopen, and then just all of the stuff added up together, that tells a story. And it's not just one isolated incident. So you have empirical studies, you have science showing that the schools can reopen for in-person instruction. You have all the weird things with the public schools opening for daycare, but not instruction, and the private sector employees coming in to do the childcare services. You know, the theory that this is about incentives and power is just so much stronger given all of that evidence. And then the anecdotes and stories on the side just kind of buttress that theory even more so. So it's,
and know, the
it's
same like, teachers every day seeing their neighbors at the supermarket and working at the bank and maybe working as an Uber driver and working at a restaurant or a post office or a city hall or an auto dealership, or it goes on and all these other people working every day. Oh, you got to pay your taxes just the same. Oh, and we get to pay ourselves just the same. But you know what? Like, we're special and you're not. Like, we have to show up every day. Or that is, you have to show up every day, but we don't have to show up every day because we're more special than you. That's the bottom line of it. That's the, it's the standard.
Either we're, yeah,
see
we're
at the bank, see at the supermarket. By the way, it's too dangerous for me to be at school.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, you know, people have said that, I think CDC even said that, that the school should be one of the last places to close and the first to reopen because of their low positivity rate in the schools and how, you know, their customers are children who are the same ones pretty much every day. Whereas with a grocery store, you have tons and tons of people coming in and out, and they're more likely to be risky when it comes to this virus because they're older populations.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So another thing happened this week, which was on Monday, my eyes popped out of my head metaphorically when I saw an interview on MSNBC, which is this guy, Michael Osterholm, who, you know, if you ask kind of most of the people who are, I would say, defenders of the status quo education, they'd be like, oh, you, Corey and Bob, you guys are just, it's all resolving. The vaccine's getting out. Yeah, there's hiccups along the way, but don't worry. All the schools are reopening. It's all fine. That's before $128 billion got blown, you know, printed today by the government. But then I saw this guy, Osterholm on MSNBC. So keep in mind all these things we're hearing. Don't worry. Vaccine. Everything's reopening. Just forget about it. Much ado about nothing. And then now watch this guy.
Dr. Osterholm, it's Willie Geist. Good to see you this morning. I know I sound like a broken record today and in other days, but let me ask you about schools. Do you see any reason why schools shouldn't be open at this point, given the evidence we have, the science we have, what pediatricians have said about the benefits outweighing the risks of schools being open?
You know, Willie, we have a collision course with destiny on our hands right now with regard to schools. I've talked about this last time I was on the show. This B117 variant from the United Kingdom is now really taking off in the United States, and is taking off in a large way in schools. Right here in Minnesota, we have a major outbreak unfolding of the likes I've never seen before in terms of the dynamic transmission of the virus. Literally new counties every day where we're starting to see more widespread transmission in school children within transmission to adults. And so I think that we're trying basically to plant our petunias in a Category 5 hurricane right now. I think the next 3 to 5 weeks, we're going to see major outbreaks in schools throughout the United States with B117. This virus is affecting kids like it is in Europe, and is different than what we saw those previous viruses. And I think we just are going to have a real challenge. We're going to be opening schools and I think closing schools all within a matter of weeks.
Never open.
We're going to be opening schools.
Never
open. Closing schools in a matter of weeks.
Again, keep them closed forever.
So if you think this is some, it's some crackpot that they got, he is in the Biden coronavirus task force. This guy is a new member of the presidential task force. He has power from the executive branch to formulate policy. He says 3 weeks we'll be closing them all back down again. All it makes me think of is, as I say to these kinds of friends I talk to who, you know, don't believe you and me, Corey, what I'll say to them is, you know, for all this I hear that you keep saying, oh, everyone's just trying to do their best and people are honestly afraid and they're all just trying to work it out and don't worry, we have the vaccine, all this stuff that you keep saying. You do realize, my hypothetical friend I'm talking to, you do realize that there are people that benefit from the closures, right? I know you say, oh, we're all trying to get through this. We're all like of good faith. No. Do you realize some people benefit from the lockdowns? Let's just start with, does Amazon benefit from the lockdowns? Do the big box stores, like big electronics or hardware stores, benefit relative to local mom and pop hardware stores because of lockdowns? Do the teachers' unions benefit from the lockdowns? Do certain political candidates benefit from the lockdowns because they have branded themselves as the "I am your savior"? I own this. Cuomo used to be that, not so much anymore. Oof. But there are all kinds of constituencies who benefit from spinning the fear as bigger than it should be. They aren't just in good faith trying to do their best, get through like all the rest of us. There are people who are essentially making more money the more fear they spread. And I see a guy like on here talking, 3 more weeks, we could be shutting everything down. I don't know what to think. So what do
all
you
these, all the other businesses are open and all the other schools are open. So, I mean, this tells you it is not about the science. It's about power. Other people can say, I'm scared to drive to work because I might get into an accident. There's always risk in life. You can't minimize risk all the way to zero. It's just not going to happen. And there are costs associated with keeping things closed that are not near zero, that are not zero at all. You have teen suicides going up this year. You had Clark County suicides by students doubling this year rather than that. So we can't just look at one side of the equation. You have to look at both sides of the equation. And all these problems started a year ago by people only focusing on the risks associated with opening the schools and not looking at any of the risks associated with keeping the schools closed. And a year later, it's unintended, but there's been a lot of harm to children academically, physically, mentally, and you name it. You've seen disruptions in the labor force that are disproportionately falling on women returning to the household because the schools are closed. There are tons of costs that people just didn't see, just didn't think about at the beginning of all of this. And we're starting to see a lot of the unintended effects.
Oh, did I disappear? Can you still
hear me? No, you're here. I can hear you.
Oh, okay.
I can see you. I can hear you.
But it's worth talking. Like, what if there's a new strain? It's possible. Viruses.
Let's study it. Study it.
Right. So I'm just going to tell you is if there is one and the Biden administration says, oh, we got to lock everything down again. You know who I say is probably not going to lock down? Florida, Texas.
No.
I think those guys, you're never, they are not doing it. All right. And so this is one difference from a year ago. A year ago, you had everyone going along with it.
You know, there needs to be more evidence if they want to close the schools back down. You can't just say, oh, well, we saw these cases in these other countries. There needs to be significant evidence of this happening in the United States. And even then, the decision should be on the part of the families to choose in-person versus remote. They know best about the risk tolerance for their own families much more than government officials in offices hundreds of or even thousands of miles away. So you can't just say there might be some evidence of this happening in the future. Let's close all the schools now. Because if you always lived like that, you'd always have everything closed because there is the possibility of new things coming all of the time. I think we just got to play it by, we got to look at the evidence and see what happens with any new strain.
I like your other point, too, about there's always risk. This is the argument of, why let cars go over 20 miles an hour? We could have a law that no car can go over 20 miles an hour in the United States. And then would it save lives? Yes, it would save lives, thousands of lives every year. I don't know how many thousand. I'm sure the data's out there. I think I've seen it before. I forgot the number. But, it would save lives. So
yeah, and that speed limit doesn't only affect you, too, because there are other people on the road. So the argument about, coronavirus and stuff saying, this affects other people, too. Well, the same kind of thing when you're talking about things like accidents, because that involves multiple parties.
Yeah.
But, we could have a speed limit of 20 miles an hour, but we don't do that because there are costs and benefits on either side of the equation. And you can't just look at one side of the equation. And I think that's been the problem for far too long.
Yes, people intuitively understand it if you give them an example like speed limit that they can understand. But you tell, but I try to do this a year ago with some of my liberal friends about who were like kind of pro lockdown, and I would call them pro lockdown, and they would get mad at me. They're like, "I don't love the lockdowns." It's just they would say they just kept saying that I didn't understand exponential. But Bob, because exponential, you don't understand viruses exponential. Oh my God, we just have to lock everybody down for a long, long time because otherwise exponential could happen. And I was like, "All right, how about exponential?" Depression, sadness, suicide. You know, there's copycat suicides too, for that matter. So anyway. Okay, did you have something else? Or
I thought you had another video you wanted to share.
I do. All right, I can go right into it. So
yeah.
So this is a pure indulgence of the viewers and listeners because it is in some ways a lot like a clip we played before. But the visual is different than the clip we played before. This is California Governor Gavin Newsom. Many of you may know he has a recall effort underway. Many of you may know they've already exceeded the signatures by a 500,000 additional signatures, 1.5 million to recall, have 2 million already. But he gave, when he announced this deal, this California giant multi-billion dollar deal that I said is redundant with the federal deal that just happened today, he was describing this in advance of it being signed, actually, and he was explaining the specifics. And we just thought it was so funny what Gavin Newsom said. We just thought we haven't done enough with this. We got to do more to show how funny this is. So that's what this video is. It's the funny side of Gavin Newsom explaining his education bill.
How many cases there have been at schools that are open? Your administration still has a document online from January 14th instructing for that data. We still don't see the data. So what can you tell us about it? What do you know? Because it seems that that's a big question that people want to know how safe these schools have been that are already open.
Yeah, so we have been providing that data on an updated basis, but we have now specifically set aside money in this agreement to hold us to account and to enforce the efforts with more transparency. We've incorporated a strike team with DPH. That's working very collaboratively with districts currently. We've codified that in language, providing tens of millions of dollars for enforcement and oversight and data collection. We put a safely reopening schools hub website up as well a few weeks back as a preview of some of the more dynamic efforts that we'll be putting into place to have more timely reporting of information. There is specific language in this agreement as it relates to reporting, 24-hour reporting requirements for any cases. It has correction strategies as it relates to multiple outbreaks and what we can and cannot do. So we are laying that groundwork very, very prescriptively in this legislation.
Just to follow up, Governor, I'm on the website right now under transparency, case reporting by schools. It's not there. So you said it's been released. Where is it?
Well, my point of the legislation is to provide much more detailed and timely information. As it relates to November, December, and January, those numbers are put up. We've been working with the legislature in the last 30 days to put together a completely different framework and strategy with different execution requirements, different criteria, and much more robust transparency, including resources to provide that information in a timely manner. So let me thank you for the follow-up, so I can lay that distinction as it relates to what's in this legislation versus what we had in the past.
Dude, he spent so much time saying nothing. Oh my God, it's just BS, BS, BS over and over again, nonstop. Oh my God. It was
nonsense.
Much better. It was much better when you lay it out like that in the video. I'm glad you put that together.
Just blithering babble, absolute corp. Someone calling
in all the buzzwords.
Speak. Yeah. Just timely manner resources, and that therefore we are going to as if that means anything to anyone. That and then the guy comes in and says, "Oh, actually, Governor, it's not there at all. I have it up on my phone right now. The data that you said is not there." Well, the purpose of the legislation is to. Purpose of the legislation.
Killed it.
Why don't you answer the question? Yeah. Why don't you answer the question of why it's not there? Well, because with the resources that we have in a collaborative team. We have a strike force that will put together, like,
we're going to use the best innovation to get us back into the classroom. We're going to do it. The information is going to be there. It's just like the longest form I've ever seen of not answering the question. Sometimes it's just a quick pivot, you know, but that was nonstop babble, like you said.
Absolutely. All right. Well, that's all I got in our shortened show.
Cool. Just a reminder to everybody, check out this website at 10:30 a.m. tomorrow, a subcommittee meeting on energy.
Hello, I'm not hearing anything. I don't know if your mic went out for just me or for everyone. I can't hear you. Well, viewers and listeners, I don't know if you can hear Corey. Actually, maybe someone can let me know on the phone if they can hear Corey. Yes, his mic is out. I was just told by a viewer. Your mic is And now he's logged off. Well, hey, everybody. So thanks for watching. If you haven't logged into choicemedia.tv, by the way, you can check out our best in class weekly email blast every Friday. And now you're back. No, now you're gone again. I do not hear you again. So, yes, it's a once a week Friday email, everybody. It's at choicemedia.tv. I don't know. Maybe this is actually good for the show. We can actually just say goodbye visually to Corey. I think, anyway, we can wait. You can wave goodbye, but thanks everyone for listening and watching to Random Assignment. That is Corey DeAngelis of the Reason Foundation. I'm Bob Bowdon of Choice Media, and we'll see you next week.